I just want to give an introduction to the mathematical modeling of water resource system here. So I know most of you are gone through the courses like numerical methods. So I will have a brief discussion about the mathematical model, what are the essential steps in mathematical modeling, and then we will discuss two important numerical methods, finite difference and finite tunnel method, and its applications. So here, in this first topic, the mathematical modeling of water resource system, what is the model and how? What are the essential steps in the modeling framework, and then what are the methodologies available for modeling? So here, as I mentioned, if it is a watershed or water, surface water or lake, or if it is an aquifer system, in all these cases, we want to see what is going on. So as I mentioned, we can integrate various systems like soft computing techniques, AN and GA, or we can integrate numerical methods with respect to GIS, geographic information system, which so everywhere, all these various computing techniques and soft computing techniques or numerical methods or geographic information system or remote sensing, all these things we can integrate together so that we can have better models, we can have better development, and then our aim is to see the variables, like either if it is aquifer parameters, then aquifer variables means it is head and concentration, if it is transport modeling, or if it is the flow is concerned, the lake hydrodynamics, the hydrodynamics in a river or estuaries, all these problems, we can develop numerical methods, and then we can identify what is happening. So various methodologies we can combine together, and we can have integrated models. So as I mentioned, the motivation for modeling is mainly to solve the problems of practical interest with a large number of complex variables. As I mentioned, so if you deal with an aquifer system, very heterogeneity will be the major issue, then anisotropy, then the porosity will be varying, hydraulic conductivity will be varying, all these things we have to take into account while modeling. So we are trying to represent the real system in a simplified way so that we can have some reasonable way of prediction. We may not be able to completely replicate the real field system with respect to computational models, but the possible way we are trying to do that, and then we are trying to develop a model. So as I mentioned, if it is a groundwater to pump groundwater for water supply, to remove pollutants from the unsaturated zone, to reduce contamination of groundwater, and say lake models or watershed modeling, like that, various kinds of models we can develop, and then these models provide information required by say managers, whether it can be aquifer management or it is lake management, reservoir management, all this management, we need some way or another way of modeling so that it will give the various conditions, various scenarios. If this much water is pumped out of the aquifer system, what will happen? Or if the reservoir is operated this way, what will be the scenario? So we are generating various scenarios, and then as engineers and scientists, we will be generating the scenarios and then giving to the decision makers, and then decision makers will decide which way they have to go. So in all this aspect, you can see that essentially, what we are doing is one way or another way of management. That means, say, whatever we are doing through modeling process, we are helping the managers to take a managerial decision so that a better prediction, better way of say implementation can be done for the considered problem. So we need models now to solve a managerial problem. So it is helping for planning and operation of the considered system, in order to achieve certain goals without violating technical and non-technical constraints. So as the water resource system, which Professor Jyothi Prakash would have already discussed, obviously for any kind of problem, say there will be certain constraints. It may be legal constraints, it may be technical constraints, different kinds of constraints will be there, and then we will be having an objective. That means here, say if you are considering a groundwater system, our objective is to see that we want to pump as much of water possible from the aquifer system without falling the head certain level. That means, say there are certain constraints so that it will not affect the aquifer system, and then it will be replenished annually with respect to the rainfall. So within the certain constraints, we want to see how the system is behaving. So that is the analogy of any kind of modeling. So there will be an objective function, there will be a number of constraints. So within the constraints, we want to get the best. So that is what we are doing. So say for example, the case of subsurface remediation contamination caused by a spill of chemical products, as we have already seen in that the animations. So the decision, that type of decision we want to take are what kind of remedial activity should be selected, where should be the remedial activities should be undertaken and what level of activities should be involved. So like that a number of questions will be there. So through modeling, what we are trying to do, we are trying to answer these questions in an efficient way. So that is what we are trying to do in any kind of model. So a model may be defined as a selected simplified version of a real system which approximately simulates the lattice excitation response relations that are of interest. So we want to see, we have certain conditions, with respect to that condition, how the system is going to behave, that is what we are trying to do. So in any kind of modeling, we will be selecting a typical domain, and then with respect to that domain, for the given field condition, we will be putting certain assumptions and we will simplify it, and there will be a number of approximations will be there, and then we will give certain excitation to the system, and then how the system will be behaving. So that is what we are doing in the modeling. So it is finally what we are getting is excitation response relations. So that is what we are finally achieving through any kind of modeling. So all these details are there in the lecture notes. So what we can do is we are trying to predict the behavior of the considered system, and then we will be getting through modeling a better understanding of the system, and that will comply with the regulations. As I mentioned, for any kind of water resource system is considered, is it a reservoir or is it a watershed or if it is groundwater basins, anywhere there will be, we have to comply certain regulations. So to meet those regulations, so we will be doing modelings and we will be generating various scenarios, and then finally we can choose the best scenario. So in this way we can see that these models gives always information that is very key to the design of the particular system, and then that will be, that can be used for the implementation in the field. So if you consider a watershed like this, you can see that watershed is considered, we will be having the rainfall. So rainfall is one of the excitation to the system, and then if we are going to construct a reservoir at particular location, so annual basis, on an annual basis we can calculate, say, how much will be the runoff taking place and how much storage we can have at any particular location of the, for the river which we consider. So that kind of the way which the modeling which we want to do. So a model is, there will be always an excitation. So as I mentioned, for the watershed is considered, we can have the rainfall is the excitation, and response is how much is the runoff at particular locations. So in any kind of modeling, there will be the domain will be, we will be defining a domain, and then within that domain there will be certain conditions, and with respect to that conditions we will be giving certain excitations, so then we want to see the response. So similar way, if it is a groundwater aquifer system, then we can demarcate or delineate the aquifer system, and then we will be having the boundary conditions, like we will be specifying what is header at various boundaries, and then we will be seeing if there is a pumping well, how the head is varying. So that is the response. So any kind of model, there will be an excitation, and then what is the response. So that is what we are trying to model. So as I mentioned, there is a large role for the modeling in any decision making process. So we say as a consultant or as an engineer or as a scientist, you are having the problem, and the client will be coming with, say, they have certain objectives. So that objectives are given to you, and then according to that objectives you collect the various data, and then you can identify what are the possible alternatives, solutions, and then with respect to that we go for various kinds of predictions, and then we will be evaluating the objective function. As I mentioned, for any kind of model, there will be an objective function, and then there will be constraints. So you can evaluate the objective function, and then you can select the preferred alternative, and then the decision makers will try to implement that alternative. And of course, this modeling, generally any kind of, especially water resource system is considered, it is a continuous process. So once we develop the model, you have to continuously monitor whether the system is behaving properly as we expect. So that means, say, whether what we are looking for, whether it is happening. So that way you have to monitor the system. So within this framework, we can define the modeling process as, so we need a certain data, so the required information with respect to what are your objectives, accordingly you will be looking for the information. So you may collect the data through field work or from various other sources, and then you first conceptualize the model. This is the most important part of any kind of model, if it is system model or physical based model which we are going to discuss here, any type of problem, the conceptualization, and then to develop a mathematical model. So conceptualization is the part where, as an engineer, as a scientist, you have to put all your efforts. If the conceptual modeling is right, then all other things will be right. But if the conceptualization itself is wrong, then your model will not behave the way which you want. So once it is conceptualized, the next step is we will be trying to, if you are going for numerical or mathematical modeling, you will be trying to represent the conceptual model with respect to governing equations, with respect to boundary conditions, with respect to initial conditions, etc. And then once the conceptualization and mathematical model we have already selected, then we go for what kind of solution methodology you want. You want to simulate whether something in the laboratory, or whether you want to develop a computer model, and then whether it is analytical way of solving or numerical way of solving, which way you want. So we can choose it, and if a software is available, you can choose that particular software, or you can develop your own computer code or numerical model, and then you can go for predictive simulations. And then, as I mentioned in this, there will be, say, most of the time we are trying to simplify a real system, a real field case with respect to various assumptions. So there will be number of uncertainties will be there, sensitivity for each parameter we have to do, and then we have to come back and again go for predictive simulations. And also some of the other aspects are calibration. That means you are trying to develop a model for a given field problem, so you have to calibrate various parameters with respect to the behavior of the model. And then of course, whether your model is giving what it should give, so you have to validate the model, and then you have to finally again come back and do the predictive simulations. So like this, so here various steps, we will have a brief outlook with respect to the flowchart. So in any kind of modeling, the procedure starts. The step number one, we identify the information required for management decisions. So as I mentioned, we are say as engineer or as a scientist, say a client will be coming to you, or your manager will give a problem to you. So that means the objectives are known to you. So this way they want to say, for example, if it is say groundwater well is to be established, and then the owner wants to see how much water can be pumped without creating any problem to the aquifer system. Or if a state government is planning to construct a dam and a reservoir, then here they want to see that, say, for the given rainfall, how much water can be stored at a particular location where the dam is going to construct and the reservoir is there. So how much can be the storage for the given annual rainfall conditions. So the objectives are known. So once the objectives are given to you, then next step is you can identify what kind of information are required to solve the problem. So say, for example, the groundwater flow model, as I mentioned, the various things here, the water levels at selected points, spring discharge, boundary discharge or recharge, concentration of specified points, geological parameters, hydraulic parameters, etc. So you can identify what are the parameters or data needed, and then you can say that this is the first step in any kind of model. So based upon the objectives, what is given to you, and then you can visit the field where you are, say, the modeling is going to be done if it is required, and then you can define the domain of the problem. And then next step is development of a conceptual model, as I mentioned. So here the process is that the real problem is very complex, so the complex problem we are trying to simplify, so to make a mathematical model. So in this process, a number of assumptions we have to put, and then you have to conceptualize the problem. So the conceptualization, whether you want to develop a three-dimensional model, or you want to have a two-dimensional model, or a one-dimensional model, depending upon what kind of things you want. Say, for example, when you are doing river model, so it is with respect to flow of the river, we want to see how the velocity is changing, or with respect to the head is changing. So in that case, a one-dimensional model may be sufficient. Or if you are doing an aquifer model, most of the time a two-dimensional model may be sufficient. So depending upon what kind of the way you want and your resources, you can identify, you can simplify the system, and then you can conceptualize the system. So in the conceptualization, the important parameters which you have to consider, the geometry of the domain. So that is very important. You have to delineate whether the aquifer system or watershed, or with the area where we are going to model. So the geometry is very important. And then the effect of various parameters, if it is acufer system, it can be heterogeneity or anisotropy, or if it is watershed, then how are the land use, land cover, and then various other other parameters we have to see. And then with respect to all these parameters, you will be conceptualizing the model. So the conceptualization, as I mentioned, it is the most important part. So here the objectives of the investigation, according to you only, we will be conceptualizing the problem. And then what are the available resources? So when you are going to do, if you want to see the aquifer head variation, if you want to do a three-dimensional model, you may need a very high power computer, or even sometimes three supercomputer may be required to model a large aquifer system. So instead of going for such a complex model, even if you develop a two-dimensional model, that may give the results which you want to certain level of accuracy. So that way, depending upon the available resources, you can simplify the problem, and then depending upon the data availability. So you can see that especially this subsurface or groundwater systems are concerned, you can see that most of the time the data is a major problem. So you have to you have to limit your modeling in such a way that with respect to the available data or whatever data you can collect, accordingly the modeling should be done. And then of course the legal and regulatory framework which pertains to the considered case. So that is what there will be technical constraints, there will be legal constraints, there will be non-technical constraints, so number of constraints will be there. So you have to conceptualize your problem accordingly, so that we will be having the best model. So the conceptualization is the most important part. And then, as I mentioned, once the conceptualization is done, then almost 50% of the work is over. Since accordingly, if the conceptualization is done properly, then you can give the work even to your assistant, so that other things are much easier. So once the conceptualization is done in step number 2, step number 3, development of a mathematical model. So here in this step, the conceptualization model is expressed in the form of mathematical model, which may consist the definition of the geometry of the surfaces, whether it is rectangular type surface, or is it a three-dimensional model, or is it irregular boundaries, then equations that express the balances. So you can see that the hydrodynamics is concerned in lakes or rivers. We may use the Navier-Stokes equations, or we may use St. Venant's equations, or the groundwater is considered, we may use the flow equations and transport equations. So the equations that express the balances, and then flux equation that relate with the flux, that means how much is the inflow coming to the system, how much is outflow going from the aquifer system, the considered system. And then if there is sources sinks like a pumping, then recharge. Then of course, if you are going for a transient model, time dependent model, of course the most important, we have to start with something. That means when time is zero, you have to see what is the head variation, concentration variation, that is the same like the case of hydrodynamics in rivers or lakes. Also we have to see what is the water level conditions, that is so called initial conditions. And then of course the model is behaving according to the given boundary conditions. The initial condition is, when for a transient model, the starting we give some conditions, that is so called initial conditions. But boundary conditions, if how accurately you represent the boundary conditions, accordingly the model may behave in a better way. So the boundary conditions are very important in any kind of model. So this is the third step where we develop a mathematical model. So then once the mathematical models are developed, now you can take a decision what kind of, whether for the given mathematical model, whether there is an exact solution, that means mathematically analytically you can solve it, and then you can find out a solution that is maybe available in literature. So you can choose if it is available, but most of the real field problems are considered, the analytical solution will not be possible to apply. So you have to go for some approximation for the mathematical equations which we have already developed, or which we have already obtained in step number 3. So here we may use the numerical methods like finite difference, finite element, or various number of methodologies are available in literature. So you can choose, say this depends upon your familiarity. If you know finite difference method, then you may go for finite difference method, but the accuracy may slightly vary, but depending upon your familiarity, how much time is given to solve the problem, and then what kind of software is available, accordingly you can choose the numerical method which we are looking for. So as I mentioned here, most of the time some software may be available, so it will be better to purchase the software directly and solve it, or you can develop your own codes. But only when you develop a code, of course you have to verify how your model is behaving. So next step, So even if you buy a software also, most of the time it will be very good to verify the code, what is whether what we are looking is the software which we develop or which we buy, it will be having say its own objectives, that it can do say what kind of simulation, all these things will be given. So we want to see that whether it is giving what it should give. So the verification involves comparing solutions obtained by using the code with those obtained by analytical methods. So if any analytical solution is available for a very simple domain, you can apply the code and then see that with respect to that analytical solution whether you are getting we should get, so whether how much accurately we can get the solution. And then if any lab models are, laboratory models are there, that also you can try to simulate and see that whether the code is giving what it should give. And then next step is, so model verification is not to be essential that with respect to your field problem, but the model validation, next step number 6 is so called model validation. So the model validation is now we are directly coming to the real objectives of your work, and with respect to your objectives, so if say for example for an aquifer system, if you are trying to model and if any observed values are available, then you can just check with respect to the observed values, you can develop the model and then you can run it and see that whether you are getting very near to that value, what is available with respect to field observation or with respect to laboratory if any model is available. So the model validation can be with respect to laboratory experiment, very similar way which we develop for the given field problem, or if any field values are available, we can use that. So that is step number 6. And then as I mentioned, the step, since these are all very not so complicated things, that is why I am going slightly faster. So the step number 7, you can see that when we are dealing with any kind of real problem, real field problems are considered, it is so complex, we will be assuming a number of parameters, we may assume many of the variables with respect to given system. So like an aquifer system is considered, we may see that the hydraulic conductivity will be varying, actually for a heterogeneous system it will be varying from one point to another point. So you cannot do all these kinds of say modeling with respect to continuous variation. So what you do, you may see that okay, the K value for this particular zone is 40 meter per day, another zone is 50 meter per day. So like that you may be doing a zonation and then you will be putting the parameters. So very similar way the porosity is considered, we may be giving some parameters. And then say if you are dealing with the hydrodynamics, so then what is the eddy diffusivity, what is the values of the various coefficients, then we may be putting certain with respect to the field condition, what is available with respect to literature or with respect to some field measurement, we will be putting to the model. So but actually to see that what you are putting is right with respect to the total behavior of the model, you have to calibrate the model and then you have to see how the parameter is working properly or not. So the step number 7, we calibrate. So the calibration is generally done with respect to say for example for the given problem, if some field values are available, then you can assume certain parameters say to the reasonable range and then you can run the model and see that what is with respect to the observed values, whether you are getting the same very similar way to a certain level of accuracy. So then if it is not getting, you can slightly again change the parameters and then see how the system is behaving. Nowadays say actually the so called soft computing techniques like ANN, genetic algorithm, etc., we can use for inverse modeling. So inverse modeling is that we can combine the so called numerical methods with respect to the artificial neural network, and actually you know that artificial neural network type soft computing tools are just like a black box. It is not, what we are discussing here is very much based upon the physics of the problem, but the black box model like artificial neural network, what it is doing is say we are having some input, some output, so it is trying to generate some correlation between the input and output and then just trying to predict. So but in the real physically based model, we are trying to really simulate what is happening within the field. Even though the modeling is very complex compared to the just use of the black box model, but if we can combine together, so nowadays what we are doing most of the time, we may combine these kinds of numerical models with respect to a soft computing tool like ANN, genetic algorithm, etc., so that wherever these parameters are there, model the parameter estimation is considered, we can do a true inverse modeling, we can find out the real parameters with respect to some of the observed values. So if we can combine the numerical models with respect to the soft computing tools, it was found that very good way where your prediction is possible. So step number 7, we do model calibration and we do some parameter estimation. Then, so also most of the time we may go for, you can see that say each of the parameter will be with respect to the parameter variation, there will be a lot of variation with respect to the given variable. Say for example, the head is considered, say if the K value, the hydraulic conductivity is for 2% varying, 5% varying, 10% varying, so then you can see that the head also will be varying accordingly, or the velocity also changing accordingly. So you can do a sensitivity, how sensitive is your model for the given condition. So you can do this through a sensitivity analysis. So the sensitivity analysis is also very essential when you are especially developing a model. So once you do these 7 steps, now your model is ready for application. So application means now what your client want. Your client want to see, say for example, for an aquifer system, oh, this much is pumping, now how the head will be varying in the aquifer system. Or if a condominium plume variation, then if this much is pumping out or this is the condition, they want to see how the scenario. Or lake hydrodynamics or river modeling, everywhere. So for the given condition, they want to see, the client want to see what is the real condition. So now the first the 7 steps which we have discussed is to make sure that you are having a system or a modeling system where you can apply directly and get solution. So in step number 8, now you are doing the problem, the real problem, and now you will be getting the output, and then you can just simulate various scenarios for the given conditions, and then you can get the results. And then in step number 9, generally you can see that most of the time a number of uncertainties will be there, or stochasticity. That means, say for example, we are dealing with reservoir operation, or we are dealing with the watershed modeling. You can see that even though we say that annual rainfall is known, but you can see that a lot of uncertainty will be there. Probability, it is very much, say even if we assume that it is 115 centimeters the annual average rainfall in India, but it may vary from one location to another. Sometimes it may be more, sometimes it may be less. So we have to see the uncertainties, what are the uncertainties, what are the probability of the various given conditions. So uncertainty analysis is also very important in these kinds of modeling. So this is about many elements associated with the model, such as is selected construction model appropriate, are the values, various coefficients used are correct, are the selected boundaries are appropriate, or the excitation, that is mean, as I mentioned, if the rainfall is this much is possible, or it can totally vary. So all these parameters we can do an uncertainty analysis, and if it is needed, we can go for stochastic modeling also. So stochastic models, the information coefficient introduced, say what is the probability distribution, what are the possibilities, so accordingly the system may change. So that also we can do in the type of model which way we may go. So now once all these 9 steps are done, now you can come with now you have already simulated various scenarios. So now you can summarize, yes, if this is the condition, these are the output, these are the results. So now you can analyze your results, then you can graphically represent the results, and then you can put certain conclusions. That means for this given scenario 1, these are the conclusion. That means how the head will be varying, how the concentration may be changing, how the lake hydrodynamics will behave, or how the reservoir operation can be controlled. So all these things will be coming as conclusion for the given conditions, and then your next step is model reporting. So I hope all of you know what will be there in the model report. So you may start all this what we have discussed, there will be definitely should be there in the report. So you may have the abstract, and then introduction, modeling objectives, conceptual model, mathematical model, model coefficients and parameters, code selection or development, model calibration, parameter estimation, model runs, sensitivity analysis, stochastic analysis, and then your own predictions, and then results and discussion. So this is a typical model report, just like what you will be doing. So in all these things you can see, we are trying to simulate a real system. So don't think that whatever is given completely correct, that is most of the time it is not right. So you should apply your mind in such a way that the model use is concerned. You can see that by running the model, what is to be expected in the future we are getting, and observation and early warning network can be designed. So that is the purpose. But most of the time there will be, we cannot always say it is 100% right or 90 even say that probability conditions we have to always tell the clients, so otherwise the clients may think that okay, they are given this and then that should be completely represented. You can see that most of the time the clients coming to you, they may not know many of these aspects, so you have to specifically say the model use, model applications, how much reliable the model is, how much sensitive various parameters, and how you have put this model in this framework so that the system may behave accordingly. So it is all this aspect, model use, model applications, the reliability of the model, then the limitations of the models, the advantages of the models, all these things you may have to specifically say in your report so that say it will be clear. Nowadays you can see that say you cannot hide many of the things. Now in India also, even earlier in Western countries it was, in India also the Right to Information Act is very much there, so you have to see that whatever you are putting, it should be very clear. You have to write everything clearly, otherwise what happens that say the clients may go and sue you in the court, so that you will be in trouble. So for example, recently we did some work for the New Bombay Municipal Corporation, and then what has happened is that it was actually say there were, so you know that while dealing with the contracts, there will be a number, the contractors will be trying for a particular work, and then there will be contractors rivalry. So what has happened is Sitco has given, the Navi Mumbai Corporation has given some work to particular contractor, but we were not involved, IIT was not involved, but we were only checked their proof, that means whatever the report is right or not. Then what has happened is opposite, the contractor who could not get the work, he went to write RTI. You know RTI is very powerful now. So now the RTI came and told that okay, IIT has to give entire what is given, for whether we want to see what you have done is right. Actually there was nothing, we have done completely correct, everything is right, but the rival contractor, they want to see that this work is not, say since they could not get the work, so they want to see, they want to put the municipal engineers in soup and the opposite contractors also in soup. Then what has happened, we have to show A to Z to the RTI. And then what happens, you can see that most of the time we are all in another soup. The problem is that we are having a contract obligation with respect to the client, that means the other contractor, who has mentioned that whatever they are given, we cannot disclose to anybody. So we are in a soup. Since and as per RTI, Right to Information Act, we are supposed to give everything. But from the other side, there is legal complications that if you give this thing without their consent, then we will be in prison. So these kinds of issues will be coming. So what we need in any kind of reporting, you should be very careful, since now all the people are very sensitive, they know what way they can get the things. So most of the time there will be rivalries between the contractors or the companies. So this also you have to, as a consultant, you have to deal all these aspects. So just I told a small example, we are in a soup last month regarding some work we did for a municipal corporation. So anyway, we'll come back to our modeling. So now we have seen the total framework of the model, starting from our objectives, then to the reporting. So now my purpose of this lecture today and the afternoon is about the modeling techniques. So the, as I mentioned, there is, say now once you develop a conceptual model and then we are having a mathematical model, now next step is what way you want to solve the problem. Since now once you develop the mathematical model, that is only the first step for the solution. So the solution is concerned, as I mentioned, there are a number of methodologies available. So the first one, you can say, you can see that most of the time we are engineers are very much mathematical oriented. So once you get the equations, you will be looking to the equations and then see that whether there can be an exact solution available for that equations. So that is where we can use the method called analytical or exact solution. So you can see that most of the problems, since you can see nowadays, not now, last 30 or 40 years, people are trying to do PhDs, masters, all this. We want to do something to show that we are doing something all the time, that everybody knows. So all the problems, most of the problems are already solved, let me tell frankly. So that is why we are trying always to couple something with another, so that another creation will be done and you may get PhD or you may get a master's thesis or whatever it is. So all the time most of the works are done, and if you dig into literature, most of your problems can be, if you are working as a consultant, I am saying, most of your problems are already solved, and you can, only thing is that you have to take something from somewhere and knit it together, and then your solution will be there. But say that see that, you should understand, you should have broad knowledge. So most of the time when I teach masters and PhD students, I tell that even though it is, you may think that why the professor is giving so much broad based knowledge, it is not required, but see that if the things are available, if you know, if you immediately to click on your mind, no need to study in detail, but if the things are available, then immediately you can go and refer and get the things done in a very fast mode. So that is what the you should know the, all these things at least in a broader way. So the solution methodologies are concerned. The first one is analytical method, and then second one is so-called physical method. So physical method, you can see that before this computational methods were coming to picture, say by 1950s or 60s, after the first computer has come, and then there was a revolution in that area. But before that, all the time people say, if you want to see how an aquifer is behaving with respect to pumping, what you have to construct in to certain scale, and then there will be Reynolds law, Froude law, there will be a number of similitudes we have to apply, and then you have to construct and then see what is happening. So all of you would, at least some of the in your laboratories, there will be some or another way of physical model will be there. So with respect to that, so you can simulate, say, the given conditions, say, and then you can find out what will happen realistically. So even though it may not truly represent, since you are there also, you have to see, put a number of approximations. So even though it may not truly represent what it should give, so physical method is very much used for a long time, maybe more than hundreds of years, and then also still also it is very much used. Actually last maybe 1990 during that time, so what has happened is, you can see now in most of laboratories, even including in our IIT, so most of the laboratories are in very, very bad conditions. What has happened is, in 80s and 90s, when these computers came into picture, then people thought that we don't need any kind of laboratory. It is everything we can do in simulation through the modeling. But what is the reality is that it is not right. So many of the things, say, there is limitation for the computational models. So we cannot completely replace the physical models with respect to computational models. That is why now there is a revived interest in physical models. And in most of the good universities abroad, as well as now also, we are making good laboratories. We are in the process of making good laboratories here in IIT also. So physical method has got its own advantages, and then in the overall way, it will give a better way of visualization than any kind of computational methods. So the second one is a physical method, and then computational methods, or both of these can combine together. Most of the numerical methods we cannot solve without computer. So computational methods, what we are trying to do, we are having the governing equations, we are having the domain. So with respect to this, all this, we are trying to develop a computer code, and then we will be writing the code, and then we will be applying the boundary condition for the numerical model, and then we will be trying to solve. So this analytical method we have all discussed. I am not going to the details. Physical method also we have discussed. So computational method, as I mentioned, the solution is obtained with the help of some approximate methods using a computer. Commonly numerical methods are used. So wider class of mathematical formulations and advent of fast computers. So this was possible by the development in computer technology in last 1960s onwards. So that is where the development of various numerical methods started, and now the last 50 years many of the problems are solved using the numerical methods. So if you go to the literature, you can see that even though the basic aspects of this computational methods or numerical methods were developed in the end of 19th century or the beginning of 20th century, but since when we tried to solve the real problem, it was a large number of system equations to be solved, and then it was impossible by the human mind or human way of calculation or even the calculators. So that is why a computer was always required, and by 1950s, after Second World War, computer came into picture, and then first method came into picture was finite difference method, then finite element method, then finite volume method, and boundary element method. So number of methodologies came into picture. So we will be discussing briefly in this course two methodologies and then related softwares depending upon the availability of time. So in the finite difference method, I will be discussing detail in the next, that after this 5 minutes I will be discussing finite difference method. So I am not going to the details of finite difference method in this session. So here What we are trying to do, we are having the given equations, we are the variations are represented with respect to a set of points or grid of intersecting lines. So these details will be just after few slides, it will be coming. The finite difference method we will be discussing detail, and in finite element method what we are trying to do, the region of interest is divided in a much flexible way, and the nodes at which values of function is found have to lie on a grid system or a mesh system, and then we are putting the boundary conditions to solve the system. This also will be discussing in detail in the afternoon. And then some of the latest techniques like boundary element method, it is not so late, but maybe 20 years or 25 years old. So here the partial differential equations are represented as in terms of an integral equation related to the boundary, and then we apply a technique called Green's integral theorem, which was developed by the end of 19th century, and then we are trying to represent what is happening within the domain with respect to the boundary variation. So this is the technique of boundary element method. So this is also very much used nowadays. So we will be discussing in detail two methodologies, finite difference and finite element method, and its related software for water resource planning and management. So in all this, when we are using the numerical methods, there is, you can see that there are three steps. One is, first one is called a pre-processing. Pre-processing means, say, we have to set the domain, and then we have to discretize. If it is finite difference or finite element method, we have to discretize the domain, and we have to set the boundary conditions, and we have to set the initial conditions. So that is the step so-called pre-processing. And then second step is processing. The processing what we are doing, so we are writing a computer code. We are writing with respect to that computer code, we will be running the, when we run that computer code, say that the original Gavani equations we are trying to solve with respect to given conditions. So that is so-called processing. And then the last step, once you process, once you run the model, what the computer gives? A number of numbers only. So that numbers, if you give directly to the clients, your client will not understand anything. So you have to process it such a way that you can create graphs, you can create contours, you can create animations, you can put it appropriately in tabular form. So this third step is the post-processing. So in any kind of model, we have to pre-process, then processing, then post-processing. So with respect to this, say now before going to finite difference method, if you want to have any few minutes discussion, we can have it. If you have got any questions, we can, you can ask.